Thank you, everyone. We're about then to start our third presentation, followed by a panel, but our final presenter is Dr. Vicky Chartrand. Vicky's a mother, a full professor in sociology department at Bishop's University Quebec, the traditional territory of the Abenaki people. She's also an adjunct professor at the University of Ottawa, criminology department, and founder and director of the Centre for Justice Exchange, a research centre for collaborative community justices. Her research includes penal and carceral politics and modern-day colonialism, community-based and grassroots justices, and anti-colonial, anti-violence, and collaborative methodologies. So welcome, Vicky.
Oh, thanks. Is this working? You guys can hear me? Thanks for having me. It's an honor and privilege to walk these beautiful lands. As noted, I'm coming from, I work and live on the Abenaki territory. I want to thank the, first I want to thank the speakers. I think that's really important. You guys are sharing a lot of yourselves with us, and we appreciate that because there's always a vulnerability when you're talking. And we really want to thank the organizers. I think it's a really invisible labor that doesn't get acknowledged, but it's so vitally important to all of this work. So a good hand for, just for the organizers and laborers, yeah. And also importantly, I wanna thank all of you here today, and folks online as well. I appreciate your presence and your troopers. I mean, this is like a slog, you know, 3 hours of just sitting and listening is not easy. So I appreciate your presence and energy here today. So I'm gonna get a move away from the PowerPoint. I wanna try to build some kind of relational rapport with everybody here in some way, because you know, even though it's fleeting, it's still a sort of form of community. And we build some kind of rapport here today, even though it's, you know, at the end of the day, we may not see each other again. So it's noted that my background's criminology. I do quite a bit of work around, you know, the prisons and the justice field, but I come at this work as an anti-violence worker. That's how I step into it. And I think that, coming in from an anti-violence approach has brought me into stepping into very different kinds of work, particularly with Indigenous communities. And it's coming as an anti-violence worker, that's where I step into this work. So what I thought, you know, there was the question earlier on about how do you do this work in a good way? And I know that as we've been talking a lot about these terms like decolonization, reconciliation, indigenizing, And for me, they're complex terms, and to be honest, I'm not even sure I understand them, even though I've been probably doing this work for a good 25 years at the very least. And so I think it's important that we talk about, how can we do this work in a good way? And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to offer 5 propositions. I'm not going to tell you what they are. We're going to go into this like a blind river. We're going to explore it in all different kinds of ways. And if you feel like, and I don't get it right all the time, you know, who am I? Like, I don't get it right all the time. So if you have anything to say or add or if you need to interject, feel free. Okay. I think for the first proposition, I'd like to say is that you have to be in community. You have to do this work in community. There's no way that you can move forward. And it builds on what some of the things that Rye was talking about, that we take direction. Right? We take direction and that we're in service. And even when, and I'll tell you about my community and how I stepped into it, because it's not to say that's the right way or the only way, but it'll give you a sense of how I stepped into it. So, I was a criminologist and did an undergraduate, and I took a course called Penal Abolition. And it was about abolishing systems of punishment. And what it highlighted for me was that violence occurs in all kinds of arenas, right? And it occurs not just in the interpersonal level, but also within institutions. And in fact, institutions impose the worst kinds of violences. And I also had it was Professor Robert Gaucher, and he's an old revolutionary, 60s revolutionary professor, and what he said to us, he's like, but you know what? And pardon my language, he's like, but you don't have to take my bullshit. You don't have to buy into my bullshit. He's like, go find out for yourself. Why don't you go into the prisons and talk to the people? And it was the first time an expert was telling me, you know, don't listen to me, go find out. And so I did. I started going into the prisons about 25 years ago, and I haven't stopped going. In fact, we were just talking about, I was at the special handling unit here in Quebec, Saint-Anne-des-Plaines, just in September. And if you're not familiar with the special handling unit, it's the super maximum here in Canada. It's tantamount to, you know, Pelican Bay out in California. And it is, it's an institution of isolation. And of course, when you go into the prisons, you can't not interface with Indigenous folks, because we know that going into prisons that we incarcerate Indigenous folks at such high and exponentially high rates. And I want to talk a little bit about that and why we do, because I think that's that context of colonization is still healthy and well. And I think for the speakers, I mean, we're stepping into a place of high tensions, because colonization is still happening today. And I'll explain that to you, because I think this is a really important piece that a lot of us don't realize, is that, you know, we often hear about the over-incarceration of Indigenous people, and that's the idea that Indigenous people are 5% in the general community, but in the prison system, they represent 32%, and this is at the federal level, 32%, and Indigenous women, it's up to 50%. And I've been doing this work for a long time, and I've been hearing that narrative for over and over again. I'm like, well, when did it happen? When did Indigenous people start being incarcerated? And I thought, oh, it must have been since the onset of colonization. We just used prisons to lock folks up, Indigenous people. But it's interesting, we didn't. It wasn't until the 1960s that we started incarcerating Indigenous people. In fact, I read the reports going back all the way to 1838. And, you know, us white folks, we like to keep nice, detailed, long reports about what we do and how important our work is, right? So there was like, I was reading 200 pages every year of these colonial penal reports. And in fact, they really well documented the race of every person within their prison system. And Indigenous people only made up 1-2% of the Indigenous prison population. And in fact, around the Northwest Rebellion, when they made all those arrests and they hung and murdered the eight leaders, the incarceration rates went up to 5% and then went right back down. The warden was talking about the expense that Indigenous people were creating. The surgeon was making notes that Indigenous people had weak constitutions. The chaplains were talking about how the Indigenous people were so amenable to rehabilitation and reform. They were doing everything they could to get them out of prison. They would give them pardons, tickets of leaves, right? So this is what, and then all of a sudden, in the 1960s, we start to see the rates go up. Well, what happened? What happened in the 1960s? And if we go back to Rye's work, what happened with residential schools? Right, in the 1959, we saw the abandonment of the requirement of residential schools. We also saw the decriminalization of the potlatch and different ceremonies. And we saw the receding of formal assimilation policies, and we saw the receding of the Indian agent. Well, as the Indian agent was receding in the regulation and control of Indigenous peoples, we saw child welfare rates increase. When we talk about the 60s scoop, that's exactly what happened. So a very negative institution, it went from one negative institution to another. It went from one governance institution just over to the next. And these are what we call carceral logics. These are all just carceral systems that take over from one to the next. And in fact, lots of scholars talk about this in terms of colonial shape-shifting. And so did the prison. In 1965, we had 11% Indigenous population rates in the penitentiary. Provinces are a little bit different. I'm just talking about the penitentiary. So they shifted from the Indian agent to the prison. And in 1967, the Canadian Correctional Association did a report. They were commissioned to write a report on why are there so many Indigenous people in the prison system. And they came up with all kinds of reasons. But what happened was that we started to pay attention. So these terms like indigenizing, they've been indigenizing the justice system since the 1960s. We've had all kinds of reports and commissions and task forces and shifts and changes and introductions. We even have healing lodge prisons now, like think of it. And all they've been doing is introducing reform after reform after reform to make it better, make it better, make it better, and guess what's happening? Indigenous incarceration rates have only been going up ever since we've been trying to reverse the very trend that we're saying we're trying to reverse. So for me, in my work, and this, I'm talking about this kind of research, is that, so part of my community is prison community. because I don't want to do this work. So I'm studying, I study the system and I study colonialism, but I don't want to do this work without taking direction from those in the community and whose lives I'm actually impacting. And for me, these aren't just ideas. It's people's lives. And I know I get evocative. I mean, you know, I've lost important people. I got a phone call. I get hundreds of letters. I take phone calls every week from folks inside. I talked to someone in the special handling unit not too long ago. He was talking about he experienced sodomy with mace, with guards mace, just a few weeks ago. These are the things we don't hear about. We never hear about this stuff. Colonialism, and you know, to use Foucault's terms, but colonialism also went underground, and it's hidden now. And so there's no way you can't do this work without being in community and talking to the people in which it's happening. So that's one community. But as we talked about, I do this work around justice exchange, and so my other community, and justice exchange is this idea of looking for alternative and diverse types of approaches to justice, and particularly community justices. So I work with the folks where justice just isn't present, and that's for sure in the prison. It's a silent system. But also I work quite a bit with the families and the communities of the missing and murdered Indigenous women and Two-Spirit Plus. Because if you want to talk about another group who experiences high levels of brutalization and where a lack or a dearth of any kind of justice, it's with the communities. And so for me, they're not on a dichotomy or not on a pole or victim offender. It's all the same levels and layers of institutional violence that all of us are experiencing at different levels, even in these institutions. A little bit, you know, not as intense as a prison system. So those are my two communities, and what I want to do, so we'll move that. So I think we have to take direction from community. We have to be in community because you don't know. You would not know otherwise unless you're talking to the folks in which we purport to be representing. Okay. So that's my first proposition. So we're going blind here. Let's see where this goes. Okay. My second proposition is... I'll just to end that. So we step into this work because a space has been made for us, right? I didn't choose that. I stepped into it. A space, the world, the universe that created a space for me to step into it. And I give, and Vicky, and the people I talk about today, I ask for permission. And so Vicky, I had said, you know, I've been working at Bishop's University, and there's all kinds of institutional violences that get experienced. But because I never worked in community at Bishop's, that I wouldn't engage in unless I'm invited. And Vicky B said to me one day when she came in to the institution, it's not just Bishop's, all institutions have all kinds of violences, but she's like, don't you guys take care of each other? At Bishop's University, right? At my own institution. And to me, that was like, you know, this house is a mess. And it was the invitation. Now I'm like, oh, God, I got to do this work. Oh, talking about burnout. But no, and it's like, I feel the invitation. And so, okay, I'm not just an invitation. It's like, you know, do some work here, Vicky. I'm like, okay. Okay, Vicky B. So second proposition is do less harm rather than more good. I know we come into this wanting to help. And in fact, that's exactly what they wanted to do with the prison system. It came in with the helping industry came in and they made things worse. They made things worse. The prisons brutalized people. Now we're only seeing Indigenous people, more and more Indigenous people end up in the prison system. We're seeing Indigenous women going missing, even today, after the inquiry, after talking about genocide, after the TRC. So it's really important that we think about doing less harm rather than more good. And I'll just read this little blurb. So it's more commonly understood that Indigenous peoples in the Canadian state as elsewhere are overstudied, their voices are appropriated, altered, or not heard, and that research serves the ends of the researchers and often within colonial projects. Indeed, entire populations have been colonized and enslaved to the logics and hierarchies of empirical or imperial and violent knowledge production and practice. So research is not an empirical fact, but a cultural artifact that organizes very particular rituals of storytelling and by only select people. So in short, settler research produces stories, albeit powerful stories, that have massive impacts on people and have been mostly invasive, extractive, and self-serving. So when I'm doing this kind of research, I have to ask myself, what kind of story am I telling as a researcher? And scholar Tracy Baer, she says, she notes that so to be in good to do good research is to stand in good relation, and that that's not an easy position to always be in. But to stand in good relation for myself is to locate yourself within the context of your life and your work, and mobilize your resources, your knowledge, and your spirit in a way that can support, advance, transfer, build up the communities you work with. And when I say work, I'm not talking about my career, I'm talking about where I put my energy, my life force. And when I talk about community, it's like, it's community is wherever you find yourself. We all have community. And it's so important, going back to Vicky B's comment, like, how are we taking care of each other? Just right here, just right now. Okay. So we're all part of community. So to achieve this, I think about where I put my time, my energy, and my resources, because where you put your resources is really important. And when I say resources, I don't just mean money, but it's like an energy, that life force. And I was being in prison community, I had, there was a Cree man who had filed a human rights complaint with the Canadian Rights Human Rights Commission for guards who were desecrating his bundle. And they found wrongdoing, and they were looking for recourse, measures of recourse and reconciliation. And one of the things they had asked me to do, given the work I do around colonialism, is to train guards about colonialism. And my response to that was, no. No fucking way. And maybe it was the wrong response, but the way I see it is that these institutions, they've been trying to indigenize, they've been indigenizing institutions since the 1960s, and they've been doing all kinds of training, colonial training and anti-racist training. And I'm like, I couldn't think of a worse way to spend my time putting more resources into an institution and people that have tremendous resource. If you want me to sit on a parole hearing with you, I will. If you want me to provide any kind of information or lecture, I will. If you want me to write a support letter for your parole hearing, I will. I'll do that for you because that's what I think is important. That's where the energy, it's where my time, energy, and resource goes into. I am not spending one more minute trying to build up an institution. I want to build up community. I want to build up people. But that's me. I'm not, like I say, I'm not, I think everyone has, they bring important cards, and this is where it brings me to my second or my third, what's it called, proposition. So to do this work for settlers, particular settlers, white women like myself, or doing this work, it's important to know when and where to step up, when and where to step back, and where to step out. And so my third proposition then is social location matters a lot, a lot. I'm a daughter, I have a daughter, I'm a researcher, I'm a teacher, I'm white, I identify as woman, I have institutionalized wealth. And so there's all kinds of power dynamics that exist within the relationship itself, and we need to be able to identify those power dynamics that are existing within relation when you sit in community and when you're in relation. It's not enough just to do the work, but you have to locate yourself. And I don't just mean about, hey, check your privilege. I don't mean it just in that way. I think that we're all coming into the relationship with important resources, gifts, and skills that you can bring to that work, to the community, into the research. So use those vital skills and resources. You know, when I was talking to Chickadee, and again, people give me permission to use their name and the stories, but she's like, when women are stolen from our community, they don't just steal the women, they steal our gifts. They steal the strength of our communities. And that makes a lot of you, because everyone's coming in with such important, beautiful gifts. So think about your own gifts. I'll tell you, I won't tell you what my gifts are. It's, well, maybe another day, but like, I'm a bit of an a-hole. I actually have a high, my gift is I have a high tolerance for conflict. So I like, I say things that most people wouldn't say, and they're like, Jesus, you're an a-hole. And I'm like, yeah, I know. Isn't it great? but I don't want, you know, and my daughter is a peacemaker, and so I learned so much from her. She's like, Mommy, you can't say things like that. And I'm like, oh, you're so right. Like, you know, so I mean, she grows me as much as I grow her. Okay. So social location matters. So I was in the University of Winnipeg some time ago, and Negan Sinclair was actually there offering some teachings, which was very generous. And Negan was actually James Sinclair's son, and he grew up in ceremony. And he was telling us, giving us a teaching on land acknowledgments. And he was saying, you know, land acknowledgments is not just talking about the traditional custodians of the land. It's actually when you give a land acknowledgement, and this is from my understanding and interpretation, of course, when you give a land acknowledgement, you're actually situating yourself in relation to with the people of the land and the land itself. And in situating yourself in relation with the people and the land, you're also situating yourself in terms of responsibilities and your responsibilities to the people in the land. And that's how I understood it. So I start to think about, okay, so what are my responsibilities? Settler and Indigenous relations are invariably a colonial encounter. They might be fluid, and they may shape-shift, as we talked about, but they're a colonial encounter where one's social location or positionality defines the context and nature of the relationship. Right? So they are colonial encounters. So what I borrow Sean Wilson's work when he talks about research as a shared relational accountability. I have accountability. I'm accountability to the people that I work with, but it's not just an accountability because it's my responsibility, but it's because it's my community. And there is a responsibility when you're in community. Your responsibility when you're in family. We're talking about not burning out for your family because you have to take care of them and you have to take care of yourself. But when you're a community and you see that as your community, you don't want your community to burn out. You don't want yourself to burn out. So it is, again, Vicky B, sorry, but it's going back to this idea of taking care of each other, taking care of each other's spirit, holding each other up. So, and if you're working in community, you'll do that. You're not doing it because it's about all the great work you're doing or how altruistic and important you are. It's just like you're trying to fucking take care. Sorry, I swear. It's so hard for me not to swear, right? That you're taking care of your fucking house. It's terrible. Like, this is going down in history and being video recorded. Sorry, Mom. Okay. So a relational accountability encourages us to think about our roles, our responsibilities, and our work, our research, and well beyond the research to all our relations, and to think the relations of this work as a mutual exchange in the sharing of resources, skills, knowledge, and expertise. So it really, that's why I call it justice exchange. It's an exchange. When I started doing justice exchanges back in 2012 in the basement of a bar with a bunch of students from the University of Ottawa, and we're like, let's write people in prison, because I've been going into prison for a long time. So we started doing that, and the prison letters started to flow in, and we're writing people, and it was called Prison Letters. And the idea behind Prison Letters was to provide information and support. That's great. But as we started to correspond, we'd get letters back, and we learned a lot from the folks inside. We learned so much from people inside of prison. They're incredibly bright, incredibly healthy, vibrant, creative people inside of prisons. And they've done horrible things, and who have done horrible things. I don't want to not admonish that. This is exactly why I changed the name from Prison Letters to Justice Exchange, because I started to realize that we were learning just as much from the folks inside as they were learning from us or getting information from us. So it was a mutual exchange and had nothing to do about, you know, being better or less than. It was really about, hey, we're both benefiting in a mutual way. And so I'm not trying to, when I do this kind of work, I don't try to pretend that I'm not a researcher or that I don't try to pretend that I'm altruistic and all benevolent. I'm an a-hole. Like, I'm no, you know, like this. I do lots of, you know, there's all kinds of lots of problematic behaviors. We exhibit and we live in our contradictions and our hypocrisies. We live all of that. But it's just to start to see this as an exchange rather than somehow that we're, it's above and beyond who we are and what we are, particularly within our all too human reality. Okay. So within a relational accountability of research, there's not an attempt to presume the researcher is all the all-knower or even altruistic, but rather has something to author to offer through the very process of research itself. So whether that is amplifying voices, mobilizing knowledge, finding information, documenting, standing witness, providing research materials, public education, compensation, acknowledging, listening. My fourth proposition is communities are not damaged. Very far from it. And I think my example of the Justice Exchange is one of them, but there's also this implicit assumption that the research encounter is a kind of rescue, and that we can recover or repair some kind of deficit or damage. So this type of work often takes root in some of the more paternalistic narratives of colonialism that project indigenous communities within struggle or suffering, and that our own work can somehow be emancipatory. Often mitigated through white researchers like such as myself. We need to see and prioritize the idea that important work is already happening in the communities, and the research itself can unearth and harness this in a way that is significant. And I'll give an example. When I started working with the missing and murdered Indigenous women, I work with a woman quite closely with Gladys Radek. And how I stepped into this was that I, as an anti-violence worker, after my PhD, I went and worked at a shelter in central interior BC. And I met Gladys on one of her walks. Gladys has done 5 national walks across the country to raise awareness for the missing and murdered Indigenous women. This is what she's been doing for 5. And when I met her, then I was in Ottawa working at Ottawa U. And I'm at Capitol Hill on a Take Back the Night march, and who's there but Gladys Radek? And I'm like, well, God, this woman's everywhere. She's dynamic. Like, so I introduced myself again. I told her I had already met her, and I invited her to come to my class. We compensated her time and energy. And then I started working with her. When I met her, she was doing planning her 5th and last walk, and so I helped facilitate. We'd meet dignitaries, we did fundraisers, and she has this war pony. It's her car, she calls a war pony, and what she does with the permission of the families is she pastes pictures of the missing and murdered women on her car, and she drives across Canada with it as part of her work. And so we had done this, and then in doing this work, and this is the benefit and the beauty of working community, because this wasn't for research, it wasn't necessarily self-serving in any particular way. It was just, I felt like it's such important work. I wanted to be a part of it. And but as I was doing this work, what I learned was of all the amazing work that was happening at the level of the grassroots and community that no one was talking about. So Glass and I set off. She's like, "Yeah, I know, Vicky." I'm like, "Yeah, I know, Vicky. Yeah, of course you know." So she's like, "I'm stating the obvious to her," and I'm like, "Okay, well, let's harness this. Let's see if we can talk, you know, bring it out into the open." So we did a cross-country road trip, camping and talking, going into communities and reserves, and talking to the families about all the work they'd be doing around it. And so they've done things like, you know, there's a litany of vigils, there's monuments, you have community patrols, there's a woman in Portage la Prairie who offers safe passage, you have Sister Watch in Vancouver, you have Bear Clan Patrol in Winnipeg. Like, there's all kinds of amazing work that's happening at the level of community. And just to give you a small example of how communities are not damaged. So we were traveling, and when we go from the settlers, the main cities and towns, people would gawk on at her. They would gawk at her war pony in a more voyeuristic way. No one really actually approached us or said much to us. A few questions. When we get into Indigenous communities or on reserves, everyone would come out. Gladys would get out. They'd shake her hand. They'd thank her for all the work she was doing. They would share their stories with her, and then they would also offer food, they'd offer us lodging, they'd offer us gas, right? These are communities that are ostensibly, you know, coming from poverty, and they had so much wealth, you know, so much generosity of wealth. So it comes back to this idea, unless you're in community, you wouldn't be able, you wouldn't know this, you couldn't see this. So I wasn't trying to be offensive when I said that white folks just need to shut up and listen sometimes, but I know that in my own work, I had to shut up and just listen. because I know that I was trying to project an understanding all the time onto something that just didn't fit. Okay. And I think that kind of leads us into a little bit of an understanding around this, that communities aren't damaged, is that the magic is always happening and it's happening now. We just have to be able to see it. There's magic happening in this room. At every moment, there's something happening. The magic is now. We're always looking for, you know, that saying, life's what happens when you're planning for something else. Right? If we're always looking for the next piece or like what's the outcome and what's the impact, is that we're going to miss the vital ways that we come together just in the immediacy. So the magic is always happening now. Okay. Kim Tallbear at University of Alberta, she further notes that research does not have to have a positive end goal, but can hold an unknown quality. So research in this way is it grows with the encounter and activities and in alignment with those who we are in our discussions and understanding with them. All right. Oh, no, sorry, I skipped. My bad. Okay. Okay, so we need to depart from the idea that research... Oh, I already said that. Okay, so that leads me, to my fifth proposition, my fifth and final proposition. Thanks for bearing with me in this blind river. My nanny lived in a town called Blind River, if you're familiar with it. Anyway. Okay, so the fifth proposition, if it's not messy, confusing, and personally destabilizing, you might be doing something wrong. The journey needs to mess you up because it means that when you're confused, hurt, betrayed, uncomfortable, all those kinds of things, and going back to that idea of white fragility in that book, when you're feeling all those kinds of things, because that's when the magic's happening. That's when the transformations are taking place. That's when the learning moments are there. And it's not about you not learning and knowing enough. It's just about us growing, right? Part of my work with Justice Exchange is like, you know, when I talk to the folks inside, it's like, thank you for helping me learn and grow. Because that's what we're in this together. Okay? We're all learning and growing. We're all on a journey together or on some kind of journey. So we often think that if the journey or experience needs to go well, it needs to be successful. But it's actually through this process that we are learning about ourselves and each other, but also how to transform some of the more stable and coherent colonial and mainstream narratives and stories and practices. All right. I guess what I'll say, I'll conclude with that is, for this presentation, I'll just conclude with this. So I get it, and I get it wrong all the time. And being in community, you gain a more direct understanding of what happens when you get it wrong. The collectivity of people's lives are carried into the decisions we make and the ideas and activities we project into this world. We cannot afford to get it wrong, but we do. Thank you so much for listening. Yeah.